Rumors have gone around that Dr. Mundo, that's a champion, took out for. But it's banned away.
Yeah, do ban it away. Kalista, the second ban there for Legacy. So taking away one of King's strongest looking AD carries. And Sejuani, very standard jungle ban, it feels like. And
talking about 5.6 changes, the big one coming through to me at least is the Athene's Unholy Grail changes. And of course, the Ziggs changes. We could see some long games between tanks, wave clearing coming through from the Ziggs, and the Athene's change. Who does it open up but Orianna in a meta where there's ball carriers, tanky men with CC that can dive in everywhere.
I mean, if there's one player that's happy that Ziggs is back as well, it's Sharp from the Direwolves. He is a long-time wave clear player, like you said, but a Ziggs player especially for the longest time, along with his friend Rippy, who used to be on the team. It was Ziggs only. But we do have Karthus banned out, sorry, and Zed actually the last ban.
Zed is the last ban. Zed has been played consistently by Legacy in the last couple. He didn't pick up a victory in both games, but they showed so much proficiency specifically against, I believe it was Team Immunity, just being able to outplay their opponents and against Akarthus, which is the big matchup, Zed versus Karthus, both those mid laners banned away, was able to play around with a Vi, with a Zed against Akarthus, an anti-dive champion, just so well by just kiting back, taking objectives, and rotating so well. That was the Legacy way in the last couple of days, and Zed, that was the consistent flavor. It's banned away.
Yeah, it's been one of his biggest champions. Is Sylan, actually, is the first pick here. So not the Dr. Mundo that's been banned away, but a big tanky champion for Minky, you have to think. 5.6 Sylan jungle, not really a thing anymore, and Rek'Sai Morgana are the Wolves' first two picks.
I mean, I hesitate to say Sylan's no longer a jungle pick. Soulstrike still could have picked it up. I mean, there was 10% reduction in damage to monsters, meaning, okay, the jungle's slower, but Soulstrike's been such an impressive performance. 13 KDA, I believe, on that champion. The OPL special, it's been Sylan's 75% win rate and very high pick ban rate, and it's just been so strong. So just pick it up, fits Minky Wells' playstyle as well.
Yeah, great stuff there, and we do see Morgana, actually a massive flex pick for the Wolves as well. They played it in three different lanes, but Aggression Ahoy in the bottom lane, Papa Smithy. Graves and Annie are the insta-locks from Legacy.
I mean, Graves, Annie, you're talking about Burst Central coming through there, especially at level 6 when the collateral damage and the Tibbers are available. The other thing that opens up is lane swapping pastry time. No support is better than Annie in a lane, so just because from level 1 onwards has that high impact AoE stun.
Yeah, we've seen a lot of roaming in other regions where Annie is going crazy at level 1, level 2, but we'll see what they do when they get up to. I like the takeaway of Graves as well, especially against King, one of his best looking AD carries. And Botalion and King, we mentioned King is a big player for his team. They both love very short range, aggressive AD carries.
I think in general, Direwolves are going to be pretty concerned at this point, because 2 days ago we saw a very innovative strategy at level 1 with Legacy, giving level 2 to Ejim and then getting that big Alistar gank in the mid lane. Suddenly, you've got one of this game's safest 1v2 champions. Going to, of course, hit that instant level 2 Kensaion and let's go into a side wave happy to 1v2. And one of the game's most reliable roaming champions in Annie. I'd expect safe lanes to come through just because you've already got so much pressure coming through from Legacy.
And these are pretty safe here coming from the Wolves. We've got Sharp back on Xerath. He hasn't played it in a little while in the regular season, but, you know, back in playoffs, going to bring back a very classic Sharp champion. And Lucian, very safe, very standard, kind of newer AD carry.
I already mentioned 3-0 on Xerath. Haven't seen a lot of Xerath from Sharp subsequently, but this is definitely his most comfortable champion. And when you see hard initiation, they're mulling over the Urgot, but I'm talking about specifically the Annie coming through. Why not go for a champion that doesn't need to be in any more than maybe 1,000 range away from people with the long range on his spells? He doesn't need to ever be in flash Tibbers range, so it makes sense to go for the safe choice. But look who's come through the draft and what's locked in.
Yeah, LeBlanc comes through. That's a bigger point in and of itself here for Choo-Choo's, but Gragas is the last pick here for Legacy, and you have to think that's probably a jungle pick.
And it's a takeaway of sorts from Soulstrike. Soulstrike is the only jungle Gragas we've seen so far in the OPL. It wasn't a winning performance, but you could kind of see the potential. We already mentioned Gragas from the jungle. The unique thing he brings is wave clear. That's the thing you don't expect from a jungler. He does have decent wave clear on his Q, specifically if he can charge it up. And then his ganks. He has a gap closer. He's able to get those aggressive wards in early just by body slamming over a wall and getting in wards. And then the ultimate, the explosive cast. Burst potential, the ability to split up teams. I mean, Xerath, he's fairly immobile. You get hit by the explosive cask and bounced into a team, and your day's over.
Yeah, I mean, Morgana's there for a bit of protection, but you're right, it's a little bit tricky at this point, and Dial's not a whole lot of time left to decide for this last pick here, and we didn't talk about it yet. We've seen a couple of performances.
Wow.
Oh my god, I forgot this was unbanned. How could we forget that the Hecarim is open for Perfection?
I mean, both the Hecarim and the Kassadin after his last performances are scary champions for Perfection. We've already mentioned he's one of the main playmakers of this team. Legacy are the only team to ever leave up Hecarim against the Direwolves twice, in fact. One of those times, Perfection not playing. Perfection's back on this champion, and this champion single-handedly won them the game against Legacy the first time around.
Yeah, just a note, Legacy, like you said, are the only team brave enough to leave it open. They're also the team to never beat it. They have never, ever beaten Direwolves Hecarim.
I mean, it's just crazy that they left this open. They must have a plan.
They had to know. Like, that was insane.
But they had to know it was available. Obviously, they could have taken it for jungle. Not an ideal thing to do. They could have banned it away. But look at the priority ban on Fizz, Kalista, and Karthus. Specifically, the Karthus banned over Hecarim. Crazy to me.
Yeah, crazy stuff. You know what? Going to get a bit more info on this draft. Going to hand it back to Max Atlas Anderson.
Thank you very much, Pacer Time. And I am here with Derek Radier Trang. Radier, how you doing, man?
Good, thanks. How about you?
Oh, absolutely fantastic. Ready to get into this first semifinal. And that was an incredibly strange champ select. A Fizz ban, a Dr. Mundo ban, and a Karthus ban coming through. Do you have any sort of insight into what's going on here?
Well, judging by the first pick, Sion, I'm guessing that the Fizz ban was intended for the Sion. You know, Minky loves playing his Sion, and you know, we've also played him really effectively. He's really popular in the OPL, I think. I think Smithy just said he had a 75% win rate. And you know, with the Fizz ban, it really opens up the Sion pick, really allows Sion to lane freely without getting punished too hard. And I think with the other bans as well, it is really targeted towards like Direwolves playstyle.
Okay, that makes a little bit more sense because, of course, we haven't seen all that much Mundo and Fizz in the OPL thus far. But Minky Whale was, of course, always a fair bit of a fan of the old Mundo. Playing anything stupidly tanky seems to be his idea of a good time. But one thing that sort of stood out to me was the Legacy bottom lane. And you've had a little bit of experience facing this one, but Annie Graves, that is so much kill potential.
Yeah, like Ejim loves his like engaged supports. He really loves like making plays, really loves being aggressive in your face. And you know, with the Annie Graves bot lane, it really allows him to kind of like open up his like play style, really allows him to like play what he really likes playing, really likes to like, you know, be in your face, make plays. And once like Graves Annie hits level 6, it becomes ridiculous. I mean, their all-in potential is like absolutely ridiculous.
Well, yeah, that's entirely true. And the mid lane matchup, sort of very standard for both of these players. You've got Chuchu's on his assassin, and you've got the Xerath in the mid lane, the classic wave clear champion. And as an AD carry player, would you say that Chuchu's probably the more frightening mid laner to deal with? And is he going to be able to affect the map like he has in the past?
I think Chuchu's will definitely, you know, with his LeBlanc, he's going to be looking to roam, looking to pick off Xerath, or looking to pick off anybody. I mean, Sharp has always classically been a mid wave clearing mage champion, so as shown by that Xerath pick. Chuchu's, on the other hand, complete opposite, loves playing his assassins, loves roaming. And I think really, like, it really comes down to, like, whether or not Chuchu's can punish the Xerath pick with his LeBlanc. But I think, you know, if Sharp can actually wave clear freely with, you know, with the Morgana safety net mid game, you know, with his, like, with its insane range and wave clear and black shield, I think like Sharp can really get ahead of this game and take control of this game.
Yeah, and speaking of getting ahead and taking control of a game, we did hear mention of a certain Hecarim that has a fairly large win rate against Legacy at the moment. Perfection absolutely terrifying on that champion. And do you have any idea why they left that up? Of course, there was the Kassadin option as well. Perfection's had sort of his run of this champ select.
I think they've left that up because, you know, Perfection loves playing Kassadin and loves playing Hecarim. And I think that, you know, strategically speaking, it's better to either ban both his champions or ban none of them. So in this case, I think they banned Fizz and first pick Sion to, like, you know, really allow that Sion to really be played. I mean, Hecarim won't be able to punish Sion as hard as Fizz can. And, you know, Kassadin, like, Sion can, like, kind of lane freely against Kassadin and Hecarim. But, you know, but like Perfection has been so effective on like Hecarim. It'll be really interesting to see how that top lane matchup plays out.
Yeah, I'm very excited to see it, and a little bit frightened for the likes of Minky Whale and any Minky Whale fans. And the lane that we haven't, well, not lane necessarily, but what we haven't really spoken about is the jungle matchup here. And of course, Carbon has played a heck of a lot of different champions. It was, of course, Soulstrikes that did bring the jungle Gragas out for the first time, but he's back on a comfort champion. How do you think about Carbon's ability to sort of readapt to this meta and try out so many new things? Do you think that this jungle Gragas is going to be effective?
Oh, definitely. Jungle Gragas has actually been picked up quite recently in the OPL and in the OCE scene. And you know, the amount of tankiness and CC it brings out is actually pretty phenomenal. And it'll be really interesting to see how he plays against Rek'Sai, clears jungle really quickly. And you know, with Gragas's CC coming out, and like tankiness and CC, like, it'll be really interesting to see how it matches up against Rek'Sai's kind of skirmishing potential.
Yeah, I'm going to be very excited to see. But ladies and gentlemen, we're going to hop onto the Rift, so let's throw it back to our casters for our first game of this semi-final.
And welcome back, everyone. We're about to start our first game of the best of five for our first OPL semi-final here. We're doing Direwolves and Legacy. I am Patriot Time. Joining with me is Papa Smithy. And Papa, what are these team comps for our first game?
There's some crazy things going on specifically for the Direwolves, Pastry Time. The last pick, Hecarim. He had a choice between Hecarim and Kassadin. That's almost an embarrassment of riches when we're talking about perfection especially. These are the two champions showing the most carry potential on two carry tops for their carry top lane. It's crazy. There's more to talk about, but I think it's time.
Yeah, it's absolutely time to get another rift here. First semi-final game is underway. I love playoffs, Papa Smithy. It's a great time here. Legacy versus Direwolves for our first game of our first best of five. And it's not just the perfection Hecarim here. We've already talked about it a bit, but both of these comps, so much going on. Let's start. Where do you want to start, Papa Smithy? I'll let you choose.
I mean, I just want to start on the Direwolves side, because let's just talk about, you know, historical trends, because those always become relevant. We've had a long season. Every team's played their 14 games. Seeing some trading around, but Minkyu are probably going to be fine in the top, so don't need to dwell on that. Let's talk about the Hecarim in particular. Perfection himself, 1-0 on the Hecarim. Direwolves as a team only got a hold of Hecarim twice. That was with their sub Kulo, I believe, playing in the top lane. He picked up a win on the Hecarim as well. So 2-0 there. That's not a big statistic, you know. Perfection to the one win there. You move on to Soul Strikes. Up there with Jarvan is the Rek'Sai. We gave the statistic pre-week 6, I believe. He was 4-1 on J4 and 3-1 on Rek'Sai. So comes into this game 3-1 on Rek'Sai, 75% win rate. Already mentioned it during Champion Select. 3-0 is sharp on the Xerath. And then the Morgana came through in the first round of picks for the Direwolves. That's actually a significant takeaway from Ejim, because he's 3-0 on that champion as well. So if we're just talking about On the face of things, it looks like an excellent draft from the Direwolves, but Legacy, prioritizing these champions and those specific bans like Karthus, it tells me they have a specific plan coming into this game.
I mean, they have to. They knew about the Hecarim. Everyone does. It's been banned in every single OPL game they've ever been played against, except for against Legacy.
So what did Legacy know?
I don't know. Something, apparently, but their last two picks as well. Is Minky going to start a camp here? We'll go off to the Raptors. I mean, the fun just doesn't stop here for game one. Carbon's playing Jungle Gragas. We only saw one play on it. It was Soulstrikes in a loss in the last week of the OPL. And Choo-Choo's on the block. Okay, that's fine. But he has a cleanse in the mid lane.
Yeah, summon a spell cleanse. You kind of look down. What is he expecting to cleanse? You're not going to be cleansing the flash on Burrow. That doesn't work with a knock-up interaction. I mean, the Terrify coming through from Perfection, that's a decent choice. Just Sharp trying to stop him with his E, I guess, is a possibility. But it doesn't. This game doesn't scream cleanse. There's no Rammus rolling into the lane that you'd really want to cleanse. So that's less kill pressure. And the one thing Legacy do have with the draft they put together is very lane-dominating champion. Sion gets the fast level 2. He can always push out top. LeBlanc will have lane control over Sharp, specifically in the first 8 to 9 levels of the lane. And Graves, Annie, just the threat of the burst, the stun being available. There's lots of lane advantages, and then there's a Jungle Gragas. We still don't really feel like we know exactly what Jungle Gragas does, apart from what his kit does. Disruption, wave clear, he's got pretty good ganks. They're going to win 2v2s. Like, you definitely take Gragas, LeBlanc in a 2v2 over Xerath, Rek'Sai, barring, you know, very low health bars on the LeBlanc, for example. But it's just very interesting to see that they've gone for these priority picks. And the Gragas, that's kind of the big sideways pick. We saw Soulstrikes bring it out. Didn't get a victory. Had a rough early game, then kind of transitioned into a good mid game. What can Carbon show us for this pick?
Yeah, and Carbon's never one to shy away from a funky jungle pick.
Udyr.
He's played Udyr in OPL. He's played Fizz in clutch games last year as well. The man loves to mess around with the jungle meta. So if he's playing Gragas, you have to know he's got some practice on it here, especially now that we're in the semi-final. But 2v2s is what we have. We expected maybe to see a lane swap here just to bully Perfection up, but instead standard lanes. And right now, as you said, Legacy just doing fine, but potentially very dangerous to give players like King of Perfection your standard lanes.
I mean, very surprising to see the lanes up. We do see Carbon up top.
Yeah, Carbon in there as well. Perfection will actually eat away, but he's getting slowed. Knockback there as well. Minkyu are going to keep running in. Carbon with the double buffs, but no flash necessary there. Perfection still safe.
Yeah, the defensive runes definitely coming up strong. Was able to get away. No flash, of course. This is Hecarim we're talking about. He actually had to use his teleport level 1. Maybe they were expecting a lane swap, but they certainly didn't get one. And you can understand why the lane swap was expected. We talked about it pre-game. Annie roamed. Just the power of an Annie roaming often is enough to opt into a lane swap, even if the 2v2 Annie matchup is just fine from the Legacy versus the Direwolves bot lane. It's fine, but it felt like all of their strategy, and specifically their insistence to go for their own champions, not try and ban away the priority ones, suggests to me a really peculiar level 1 strat, much like the roaming Alistar. Instead, it's almost peculiar that we get the standard lanes.
Yeah, and with that, I have to think that Dialves have won at least the early laning, given that they do get to put their Hecarim, especially in the standard lane, and sort of lock down the Annie roam for a little while longer. But Minky doing just fine here in the top side. The perfection, again, this is the one problem with Sion. He's very safe. He's great in almost any lane situation, but he kind of just gives farm away.
Yeah, the kill pressure is pretty low. We've seen a lot of trading in bottom, though.
Yeah, lots of aggression, actually. King very low just off your screen, almost going down to a big 2v2 scuffle, it looks like. So he will get away. No first blood yet, but that aggression, that burst from the Graves' Annie lane, already applying pressure to the bottom side of the map.
It's always the stun, Patreon. It's the one thing you don't consider. Of course, you don't have to necessarily have the telltale ring around you to show your stun's available. You can always just pick up the shield, proc the stun instantly. It's instant cast. That's why it's such a potent threat. And King has had to use his flash and heal in comparison to Talibaka, who had to use it, but is able to control the lane, push in the minions, and will get a lot of advantages as the lane resets towards him.
Yeah, slight win in summoner spells there, Chuffer still with both of his, but you'll take it at this point, going all in, not getting it. A little bit surprised to see Chuffer with Ignite, but it's a very aggressive bottom lane from the Direwolf, so not too surprising.
We should never be surprised to see Chuffer taking Ignite. There's always kill pressure coming through from an Annie. The Ignite's just a cherry on top, so just take it, mate. Why not? He always does
it. He does. I mean, you know, had that Thresh game late in the season that I think 10-2-22, I believe, taking over as the new AD carry on Thresh for Dials for a game. But Soulstrike's now going to rummage through the jungle, see what he can find. Doesn't find Carbon, will ward up the wolves, and one's been taken, I believe, so might have already done a bit of counter jungling.
Counter jungling is interesting. This is patch 5.6, like we said, so first appearance on patch 5.6 in competitive play at all, I believe, just freshly patched through. We see 5.6, the same as the live service. Not a lot of tweaks towards the jungle champions. I believe a small nerf to the Cinderhulk item, but definitely still relevant as wow.
Good sneak in there, perfection, still holding his ulti. Has Ignite ready to go as well? Does pop it. The ulti there from Minky is going to keep him safe, but Sharp does snipe him, and the Ignite actually picks up first blood.
Sharp's Xerath is something to be feared. 3-0, but just the confidence to be able to hit that against the fast-moving Sion. That's the first part. That's the first advantage of the Direwolves. Legacy, they gave all these priority champs to Direwolves, and they're already slightly suffering for it, though they are going to try and take a very early dragon.
Yeah, that was one hell of a, I guess, three-man gank there from Legacy to pick up. Direwolves, to pick up first blood. But the dragon, like you mentioned, will go over to Legacy as Carbon, able to tank that up and maybe a couple other earlier changes. We've seen this already in the OPL, but Skirmisher's Saber, Jungle Gragas.
Skirmisher's Saber suggests to me either full tank or, you know, moving away from the ability power for sure. I'm going to expect a tank Gragas. There was some tweaks towards his W, the Drunken Rage, due to just a bit more damage to monsters, so he jungles faster. One of the reasons we're seeing Skirmisher's Saber is that after all the jungle smite changes, specifically lowering the cast range, you can't use the Chilling Smite for initiation anymore. You kind of have to get into fairly close range, use your gap closer, use your CC to be able to get in close. And Skirmisher Saber, specifically having the reveal so you can't juke away damage, you take the extra orders. We see more and more trading in the mid lane especially.
Yeah, Choo-Choo's actually could be in trouble. Little low on mana are they, and the Mimic will keep him safe. Choo-Choo's safe for now. We'll have to go home though, and Sharp going to push out the lane again perhaps and start getting slightly ahead on CS.
Let's actually look at that trade a bit closer. Remember, Cleanse and Barrier are both available. The crazy thing about a LeBlanc taking Cleanse to me is that, of course, your passive will activate when you take that damage. When you're taking the stun damage, usually you're taking a burst with it. You're a fairly low health champion, not usually going to have much resist. Your passive's going to pop. It kind of acts like a Cleanse, and then you're untargetable. You're invisible for that second or so. So again, the Cleanse is just such a surprising summoner choice. And with that trade we just saw, it could have been so different if he had the kill pressure from Ignite.
I mean, it could be. I think Barrier probably a bit better as far as combat goes, just because it is against the Cleanse. But you're right, LeBlanc, a very slippery champion. Cleanse, Tutu's, I guess, just wants to make sure that he's always doing damage.
I mean, the thing to me, though, is like, people say, okay, Barrier counters Cleanse. And I can understand that mechanic, you know, lasts for 2.5 seconds. But you play differently when you're against different summoners. When you see the enemy team, when the enemy laner has Ignite, you hang back more. You don't opt into trades. You often cede lane advantage. And given that the strongest point for Legacy is the early to mid game, where they have the huge pick pressure coming through from the Gragas LeBlanc, the Gragas Annie, depending on whether it's the bot lane or the mid lane that's seeing pressure, why not double down, get the pressure of the summoner spell Ignite rather than just the Cleanse without a really obvious need for the cleanse.
Yeah, I mean, sort of an interesting decision, but we'll have to see it develop here as Legacy. You know, upper dragon, but slightly behind in gold to Dial's first blood. But at the moment, just a lot of farming happening. We see the midlaners have gone back for their first early items. Morello Nomicon seems to be the first lookout here for Chuchus. And Sharp, as you mentioned already on 5.6, it's going to go straight back to Athene's.
So Athene's is strictly a better item now. It gives 100% mana regen when you complete it compared to the 50% from before. But the kind of deceptive thing is that now, the chalice costs 900 gold instead of 1,000. It fits your item build much better. You can get it earlier as in the bottom. We're seeing more trade, and that's an ultimate use.
Yeah, so many all-ins here as Ijim getting very low. Tallywhacker actually ulti, but it kind of got blocked by Chopper. Will go down though as Tally gets two kills. King walks far too far forward and a double kill to Graves.
Yeah, King, why did he turn around? He didn't have his flash for another second or so. Picking up a double kill there looked unnecessary, but Sharp's trying to come in as well.
Nice fancy feat though from Tally. Will be okay. Ijim trying to go after him, but Dust Ward's over. Can't follow Flash, or didn't choose to without a stun. Ready to go. No dragon to take either. No blue buff, so Direwolves won't lose too much, but two kills lost in the bottom lane. That's uncharacteristic for such a top-performing bottom lane.
And this all comes from the earlier trade when we saw the lane pushed in already. Tallywhacker was able to build up a CS advantage, get the wave in his control. Aggressively did Chuffer go in using the ultimate and the ignite, but Tallywhacker, with those extra resists from the Trugut, was able to pick up, burst two kills now, and suddenly jumps up to a lazy 800 gold advantage in the bot.
Yeah, and going in for a quick Infinity Edge as well. BF Sword and the pickaxe already completed. Carbon walked back over a fresh Trinket Ward as the other one had just timed out. So a nice bit of timing there from Carbon, but Perfection will stay safe here, and that's the scary thing. He's come back, he's got his Phage. He's actually getting gate now, though, as Carbon looking to line up an ulti. Perfection, though, will just ulti himself to save. And Legacy will take a Pink Ward as consolation.
Yeah, post level 6, although you don't have Summoner Spell, Flash, Onslaught of Shadows is better than Flash. 1,000 range escape coming through. It is on quite a long cooldown, I believe 140 or so seconds at level 1. Okay, it's not the 5 minutes of Flash, but of course you want to get all that game pressure pre-6, because post-6, he's able to get away pretty easy.
Yeah, as you can see, the Spectres count now for Perfection, so respecting some of the magic damage coming through, and interestingly, just not going for the fastest Trinity Force, just has the Phage for lane, but it'll be interesting to see if Perfection wants to keep going tanky or get into his Trinity Force, maybe depending on how his game's going.
Well, in general for this game, Direwolves are looking for a long laning phase. Xerath hits his spike around the second AP item after, in this game, will be the Athene's, or whatever his 20% CDR item is. It'll be Athene's into likely the death cap, or at least an initially large rod. That's when he gets basically on command wave clear, so he can just push the wave infinitely. Perfection, you mentioned it. He's gone for Spectre's Cowl for laning. He's going to be even more delayed on at least the Homeguard boots, let alone the Trinity Force, which are part of his core. So they're looking for a long laning phase, and that's why Legacy, you can tell, with the likes of LeBlanc, with the likes of Annie Graves, they're looking to get as many advantages early before those big item timings come through from Direwolves.
Yeah, Direwolves have won a lot of games, kind of taking games to a longer laning phase. So losing the first dragon, typical of Direwolves, but having all their turrets up and everyone's still farming, they'll probably take it.
I mean, it was scouring for statistic to show just how long laning phase Direwolves like to play. On average, and this is, remember, this is an 11-3 team, Direwolves' first dragon on average is at 15 minutes, which is, it turns out, it's quite late. Legacy, 12 minutes on average is their first dragon. You might think, okay, only 3 minutes. Let's remember, there was a game where Legacy didn't get their first dragon until 35 minutes into the game. As we see, oh, some trading.
Yeah, he's in trouble. Soulstrikes has knocked him up. Ijim's there as well with the bear. Chopper gets stunned up, but King gonna chase him in. The flash out of Tallywhacker gonna come through. Sharp trying to snipe Ijim. Doesn't get the last bolt, but Tally gets the first kill onto Rek'Sai's. Perfections walk down there as well. Sharp's got the kill on the Carbon. Tally will go down as well. And it's a 2-for-1 so far. Chuchu's now getting chased here as he actually take the very long way away. The bear will come in for a bit of blocking, but everything's okay for now, and a good trade for Direwolves.
It's crazy that Chuchus didn't get any kill involvement whatsoever. Again, I'm looking at you, Summoner Spell Ignite. Direwolves, they get the advantage, and it looks like they'll be able to pick up their first dragon to arrest the momentum that Legacy picked up,
yep,
earlier.
Right on time, just for your stat there, Pobus. They're going to be around the 13-ish minute mark as Direwolves are going to get the first dragon. Minky going to go back home, but Direwolves, they let it reset slightly, but they'll take it away, even with Soulstrike currently absent.
I mean, there's no one on that side of the map coming through from Legacy, coming through from the spawn point, so we're going to see the replay coming through. Soulstrike's finds Carbon, and Carbon, while he's good in a 2v2, by himself, he's still deceptively squishy. So both Legacy have to flash out. Soulstrike goes in aggressive, too aggressive, dies to the burst coming through from Tallywhacker. We already saw how strong he'd gotten. King finally gets his man, though, is able to take down the Graves to arrest the momentum, and it's a one-team fight, and then a dragon coming through for the Direwolves.
Yeah, but in the end, of course, Tallywhacker still incredibly strong in that bottom lane, so has a lot of kill pressure still here, now picked up the Infinity Edge.
I mean, 3-1, that's the big thing. Tallywhacker's got a lot of snowball going. Despite King winning that previous trade, he hasn't got an Infinity Edge himself. He's gone for a very early Berserker's Greaves. In terms of gold, he's 700 gold behind, so he hasn't been able to pick up that Infinity Edge, even if he'd beelined for it and not picked up the boots. And Tallywhacker, he's holding the wave. He's happy.
Yeah, and we have to look back at this top lane here as well. Of course, Perfection's coming down for that last dragon fight all the way back up to that top lane now and continues to free farm. And what's going through the minds of Legacy right now has to be, we're on a timer because this Hecarim's going to be huge and they're going to have memories of their last experience.
Now, I mentioned it already. The item timings are the big thing for Direwolves. They're happy to go for a long laning phase because we know how strong Xerath is with, say, an Athene's into a Needlessly Large Rod when he gets that wave kick, when he's really strong. Perfection, he's all about the Trinity Force power spike. He's bought a Spectre's Cowl for laning, but the Trinity Force, it's still looking on time, about 23, 24 minutes into this game. When those item timings come through, the mid-game comp that Legacy has, will it be able to stand up to all the strength that Direwolves have managed to put together with all these priority picks? I've mentioned it already. These are some of the first picks. These are almost a blind pick team coming through from the Direwolves.
Well, that's exactly right, and Sharp's just been able to farm out these waves, has picked himself up a couple of kills here as well, is 300 gold now in the lead of his lane opponent, and it's getting very, very frightening. It has to be the bottom lane here that's going to carry as Soul Strikes goes down very, very low. Ignite ticking, but she is going to get away is the Rek'Sai.
I mean, if there was a critical strike coming through from Tallywhacker with that Infinity Edge, maybe the collateral damage would have burst him out. I think that's what Ejin was thinking, just hoping for the crit, but 20% critical strike, not going to get it.
Not quite, as Choo Choo's isn't going to quite find the chain. Distortion going to get him to safety there as well. I'm going to continue to farm out these waves. But does this LeBlanc have to get going at some point in this game? Because at the moment, 0-0-0, not quite having the mid-game LeBlanc performance that Choo Choo's really wants.
Yeah, despite the fact that we've already seen that extended fight at Dragon, no kill participation found for Choo Choo's. We kind of looked at the cleanse and wondered what it really contributed to this game. They need to get going in the mid game. I mean, LeBlanc's not necessarily a snowball champion, but she's very, very strong with one item. Tallywhacker, though, it's a binding and bot.
Yeah, King actually just getting collaterally damaged here as well, which, of course, you love, Papa Smithy. Chuffer taking a bit of damage now, but Ejim probably doesn't have quite enough in order to take him down. Another stun is going to come through, but Chuffer just wanders casually away.
It just feels like Daiwo's bot lane are not respecting the item timings coming through. Infinity Edge is such a big item pickup compared to just the components in the Infinity Edge from King. The burst trade's so strong.
Yeah, but here in the mid lane as well, Sharp forced to blow that barrier. Choo Choo's actually diving underneath this turret. The last auto attack is going to be enough, and Choo Choo's wanders into the last one. Preyseeker going to find it for Soul Strikes, but does end up picking himself up a kill in the end.
But again, the Ignite, it would have saved him there. He would have been able to go in aggressively with the Distortion, Ignite, move out, and live. This time he dies. He doesn't use the cleanse once again. No use of the cleanse summoner spell in 17 minutes of play.
Yeah, well, this is the thing. And what is he picking it up for? Is it for the Dark Binding here from a potential Chuffer gank?
I mean, it's the Dark Binding. Potentially, it's maybe the Hecarim ultimate in the late game. But that's the only real lockdown we're talking about, barring perhaps, you know, Sharp stun on his E, but he can always distortion past that. So it's a very questionable pickup. I actually mentioned it earlier. Just the fact that with the passive, you do drop aggro when you fall low, so you don't necessarily need to cleanse a stun.
Yeah.
You're usually invisible during the shadows, so I'm just surprised.
Yeah, well, we'll see whether it does pay off towards the later stage of the game. King wandering up the lane, going to try and take away a Scuttle Crab here as well. Doesn't want to go toe-to-toe with Tallywhacker. But he is going to be fine. Only another 645 gold until that Infinity Edge is built up for this Lucian. But both of these AD carries looking to pick up a bit more crit. Of course, Zeal has come in for Tallywhacker, so he's starting to get up there.
I mean, Tallywhacker 4-1. We mentioned that his kill participation was quite low for his team, but you wouldn't know it from this one game.
Oh, heck no.
That's the wonderful thing about statistics. We had a whole season behind ourselves. These are the games that matter, and Tallywhacker's coming into play. On a short-range AD carry, it makes sense. A Riven main in the top lane. Pick up the Graves, does the most damage up close, seems to suit Tallywhacker.
Yeah, and we've spoken about this before, of course, Chiefs versus Legacy all the way back in finals last year, and Tallywhacker really hard carrying that one. We'll see whether he can have a repeat performance here now in the semifinals yet again, but for the OPL 2015. And Carbon looking to try and get a gank happening, but a fair bit of vision now in the bottom lane for the Direwolves.
So it's a close game, 26,200 gold, I mean, across this, both sides. Same amount of dragons, no turrets down. I'd say that suits Direwolves because, again, they have the late game scaling, specifically the Hecarim, just looking to get through laning phase and become relevant compared to Sion that's always tanky, but perhaps peaks in the mid game in terms of team fight involvement because his base damage is pretty good and they're still unignorable before the defensive items start coming through for specifically the carries.
Yeah, well, I mean, of course, he is still going to be that massive sign in the late game, almost unkillable, but like you mentioned, yeah, might just be ignorable.
I mean, that's the thing. You can't ignore a Hecarim. We're talking about the massive burst coming through from the Devastating Charge and the Trinity Force, and just how many times that horse scales from the movement speed effects of both the Rage and just, you know, the movement speed that comes out of the Zeal that builds into Trinity Force. Probably eventually going to be the a Home Guard boots coming out, and that is a scary thing. Boots, Trinity Force, and a Spectre Scout at 19 minutes. We see Aurelia struggle to get a 23, 24-minute Trinity Force. He's got a Spectre Scout on top.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Has the tankiness as well as that massive damage spike here as well, and Soulstrike's looking to try and capitalize on it. Sharp actually taking a lot of damage. He's going to get locked down by that chain, and there it is. Choo Choo's with the 1v1. Easy as you like, but in the top lane here as well. Perfection's going in onto Minky Whale. He's going to try and do something, but unable to. And after the passive comes through, actually, Tallywhacker goes for the 1v1 in the bottom lane, and King turns it around.
King does a really smart thing, flashing back and removing the chance of the point blank. Ultimate coming through from Tallywhacker. The teleport comes through. They're trying to stop this dragon.
Yeah, Chuffer doesn't quite find the bind here as well. As Soulstrikes is going to ult his way down. The dragon now going to belong to the Direwolves as Choo Choo's wants to try and come around and get some damage down, but the smite is true. And Perfection's coming through now onto Choo Choo's. He's in so much trouble. Distorts over the edge, but E-Gym. Oh, the little Annie that could is going to fall down in the pit.
Yeah, Legacy, they were just desperate to try and stop the dragon. The pick had already come through from King. They could have just backed away. Tallywhacker's only now respawning after going down to King, but all they do is pad the stats for Direwolves. They pick up the dragon with the smite, but man, Choo Choo's was close with the burst.
He was very, very close through everything at that dragon, but of course, unable to quite account for the damage of smite. But what happens at the end of that one? 3-0-1 now on this Hecarim, and Perfection just looking frightening. And this is what we've seen from him in the past, is his last Kassadin game, he was 0-0-0 for the majority of that game and then basically hard carry.
And you go back to the Legacy versus Direwolves game one, of course, that was Hecarim against Morgana. Hecarim farming up a storm, not even getting kill participation. It was just sheer CS failures. Okay, only a 9 CS advantage. But remember, this is a no-escape Hecarim. Saw an early gank, didn't fall down, farmed it up. Perfection, it's the mechanical skill of laners like Perfection and King that have propelled the Direwolves to second spot, to 11-3 in the ladder. Trinity Force, Spectre's Cow, now the Merc Treads coming through. This horse is already getting out of control.
He's becoming amazing, Papa Smithy, as Sunfire Cape is built in response here from Minky Well. Of course, that Balmy Cinder making it a little bit easier to buy in lane as well, as Choo Choo is going to try and respond to the wave clear. It is coming through from Sharp, a bit of a Sharp special when it comes to wave clear.
So let's talk about how Legacy win this game, because we're talking a lot about the Hecarim. He's looking strong. The thing that Legacy have is a lot of pick potential with the LeBlanc and the Gragas to some degree as well. Sion, no slouch either if he's involved. The thing they need to do is establish wards though, because you look down the lineup, they've got three ranged auto attackers, both of them on the shorter range side. And we've already talked about Hecarim having a 1,100 range engaged on the Onslaught of Shadows. How do you stand under a turret and siege against the Xerath wave clear and just the threat of maybe the flash on Burrow or just even the Hecarim as we speak? So I feel like sieging definitely an option, but oh my goodness, Carbon might be in this trouble.
Yeah, Onslaught of Shadows did come through, but Carbon was able to body slam his way away after stealing away the red buff. A little bit of oversight there from the Direwolves, but in the meantime, the bottom lane getting pushed in very, very hard from King. Tallywhacker is going to have to buckshot this wave just to keep it away from that turret for too long. Actually, Sharp, nice Arcano Pulse going to land onto Carbon, but body slam again going to save the fat man's life.
So the only way to get picks is to get the aggressive ward down. They have them, but remember, this is the way that Legacy undid Immunity's team comp. Their team fighting team comp was getting aggressive wards down and rotating and picking up turrets. 22 minutes into the game, the turret score is even. They're behind in dragons, and they haven't translated these aggressive blue wards you can see on the map on the enemy side into picks. The picks have been the premium, and they haven't managed to get any.
Yeah, not quite able to do so. And this is something that you actually mentioned earlier on here as well, is that was why things were looking so beautiful for Legacy previously. But Soulstrike's now in a lot of trouble. That is just going to be the explosive cast for the win. Minky Whale celebrates with an ultimate and is going to take a slow for it, but he will be okay.
It's on a pretty short cooldown. It looked amusing. As you mentioned, it was a bit of a party-like movement coming through.
That's a pick, though.
We talked about the need for Legacy to get picks. It's a start. There's no objective to pick up with it, barring the middle turret. Xerath's still alive. Don't know how they're going to take it down.
Yeah, and they, of course, have the back pocket culling as well to come through from the King. A lot of emergency wave clear from that ability if they do need it. Minky Well, heading back here to the top side, continues to farm out, but you can see Perfection's creating a lead for himself on this Hecarim now. 203 CS at 23 minutes. Not too bad. and he's gone back and picked up even more items.
And it's the consistent story of any Trinity Force user is Trinity Force into tanky. That's when you want to start team fighting. Trinity Force Spectre's Cow Warden's Mail is getting pretty tanky. Outlet's only going to get worse.
Yeah, the Mimic to come through here as well as the Distortion comes down. Actually, ChuChu's baiting out. Oh my goodness, the Rite of the Arcane comes down. ChuChu's, the fancy footwork is there and the LeBlanc survives, but the aggression probably not going to be repeated too soon.
I mean, the aggression's coming through because Legacy need to break the base. They specifically need to take down the mid turret to just open up picks. If they can't take down this mid turret, and this is Xerath we're talking about, the king of wave clear, doesn't even have the death cap yet, but the wave clear situation only going to get scarier from a direwolf's perspective. If they can't break the base, they can't get these picks, they can't get the aggressive wards down they need. They have a start, but they need more.
Yeah, and Perfection's actually devastatingly charging Minkyuel here in the top side, but he is going to be okay. Does have a lot of armor built up now. Can actually go back and finish off that Frozen Heart when he wants to. And Chuffer and Soul Strikes starting to make a move towards this top side. Minkyuel spots Chuffer. Soul Strikes still in the dark just a little bit. But this could be the dive as there's the tunnel in from Soul Strikes. A flash immediately into the ultimate. And Minkyuel, they're not going to find him this time.
Flash ultimate's the second time he's used it defensively. That kind of tells you how this game is going. Not been able to use an engage tool. That's the third out of turret. Down for Dials. Legacy still struggling to get the mid one. The push is on much more aggressively this time. This might be a significant factor. Yes, they're going to get it.
Yeah, Carbon actually getting stunned up here as well as Soul Strikes takes a buckshot. There's a flash into the Tivis here as well. Huge amount of burst from Ejim there in the mid lane as the explosion comes down from ChuChu's as well. King trying to turn this one around as the passive gets popped, but in comes Perfections and everyone starts to die as there goes the duplicate ChuChu's as Perfections now just trying to ignore Minkyuel. Minkyuel making himself difficult to ignore. And Legacy, they do get the tower, and it's a 2-for-2.
I mean, the turret and a 2-for-2, you'll take that if you're Legacy. ChuChu's does the hero thing, gets the picks he needs to. 3-1-2 is getting rolling on the LeBlanc. It took longer, perhaps because of the summoner spell choice, but it's starting to work.
Yeah, and we were talking about this before. When Sharp was 1-0-1 and ChuChu's was 0-0-0, things looking a whole lot better for this LeBlanc as far as that mid-game is concerned. We are moving towards the later stages, though, and we'll see whether he can keep this one up because they need to be finding these picks, as you mentioned.
And we complimented the wards coming through from Legacy. Direwolves, they're the ones that now need to start to re-examine perhaps the defensive wards. There's no reason that Sharp should ever be in Flash Tibber's range from Annie. He's going to do damage from so long range, no other mage can do damage like Xerath, perhaps short of AP Kog'Maw, that's not in the meta right now. So he needs to be respecting the Flash Ultimate. You can tell from the build, Talisman of Ascension and Boots of Mobility and a Distortion, all that Annie wants to do is stun the immovable Xerath, and there should be defensive wards down so that he can respect the potential of a Flash out, even if he knows that Flash is not available. Just practice, never position in the range of that ability.
Yeah, well, it's true, and this is going to allow Minkyuel as well, who's built full armor here, has a Randuin's now, decided not to go for that Frozen Heart too early. Another Glacial Shroud built up here as well. Actually, that's the one he's been sitting on for quite some time, so Minkyuel going to be very, very difficult for these AD champions to kill, and if they delete Sharp, no one else has the AP to take him down.
That's right. Delete Sharp and then deal with the rest is the plan coming through. As you mentioned, the Scion build is the telltale factor. Second dragon, two dragons apiece. It's still very, very even this game. Only 1,000 gold lead coming through for the Direwolves.
Yeah, 9-9 here as well. We've spoken about scaling, but we've also spoken about Legacy just being fantastic at using their comp in the way that works the best here as well. And we'll see whether they can carry that through, but the timer starting to run low. Theoretically, this game is Perfections again going to get a massive wave in this top lane, and this Hecarim is going to get huge. Almost has that Frozen Heart as well.
Just look at the wards that are down. The only thing that you can tell you is that you can see that Legacy have picks on the mind. That's what we expected with the Tinkon. That's what they needed to execute. You see aggressive wards in the enemy jungle, whereas it's mostly defensive wards down for the Direwolves in terms of their pinks, in terms of their reds. They're just looking, again, to farm up to late. Hecarim's getting closer and closer to that third tank item, getting the Randuin specifically. Deathcap finally finished for Sharp, just to have the most wave that you could ever ask for coming through from the Xerath. The item time is getting better and better for Direwolves. That's not to say the Legacy ones are a slouch at all, but they've got two tanks in the front line, only two damage dealers between LeBlanc and Graves. Mostly burst champions are both Graves and LeBlanc. After that burst, not a lot of damage coming through.
Yeah, and we saw that burst actually just demonstrated there as King takes a whole lot of his health bar. That chain not able to find the mark, so King is going to be okay. He's going to have to head back as well. The Unstoppable Onslaught was also used by Minkyuel to try and get a pick in that mid lane, but no joy this time either from Legacy. And It's almost like they're making desperation plays at this stage, trying to catch the Direwolves unaware.
I mean, there's no need for desperation. They've already shown that if they can get the flank, and they've already shown the proficiency of warding, that again, delete Xerath, and things look pretty good for Legacy. It's just that their strategic options this game are limited. They can't siege with their short range, and the fact that their engage options are plenty on Direwolves, and wave clear coming through from Sharp and King. So sieging's not an option. They need picks, and thus to pick up Dragons and Barons. They're only even in Dragons, and there's just been no realistic chance for a threat for Barons. So that's why Legacy, they're looking for the picks, because a pick is their only way to pick up those objectives towards killing that Nexus.
Yeah, and they also have Tallywhacker now with three items strong, the most auto-attack damage sort of possible in three items here. As Ijim, he's going to flash Tibbers onto Sharp here as well. He's found him one more time. Choo-choos gets the explosion, but Ijim takes a whole lot of burst damage. Minkywell now in the back line trying to zone out the rest of the members of the Direwolves, and Legacy, they got their pick, but now they have to get the heck out of there.
That's the second time, though, that Xerath has been assassinated by Ijim with this movement speed build, Talisman,
yeah,
and Boots of Mobility, and getting the picks. He should be able to position more defensively. There's no structures. Oh, my goodness. We do see a kill.
Yeah, that was actually Chuffer getting aggressed on here by Choo-choo's. Bit of a bait to come through as Minkywell wants to get the kill into Chuffer. Nice heal to come down from King. And Minkywell, he's going to get locked down. There's a lot of damage available from the Direwolves. Minkywell, so tanky, though, trying to get out of here. Not going to be enough, and I don't think the passive's going to net him anything either. Nice dark binding there from Chuffer.
A counter pick comes. I want to draw the attention to Sharp. They weren't fighting over a dragon. They weren't fighting over a Baron. Not even vision for either of those objectives. He should not be dying halfway down his lane with his outer turret down. There's just no, there's nothing necessitating the aggressive positioning. It's the second time. You worry that every 4 minutes, it feels like Ijim, he managed to get the turbo boots on and just lock down that Xerath.
Yeah, well, those turbo boots are certainly working as Ijim is going to find a wave here in this mid lane as well, just holding that one back so that inner turret doesn't take any damage at all. Soulstrike's going to clear out some pinks around that dragon as well. She's going to be up in another 4 minutes or so, and we'll see whether there is going to be another big fight around that objective. And that pink ward that's near the red buff for Legacy on Direwolf's side has been there for a long time.
I really wish the spectator mode could just shout out how long some of these wards last.
Yeah.
Sometimes, you know, the jungle, they'll pick it up after, say, the Trailblazer or whatever their jungle item is, pick up a pink ward, put it down there. It can last 30, 40 minutes, probably
exactly.
About 25 minutes this game, Atlas, as you point out. So it just, man, it sticks around. And 30 minutes into the game, I'm going to pronounce it. This Hecarim, he's a big deal. Trendy Force,
yeah.
Spirit Visage, Frozen Heart, and even the Home Guard boot...
Mercury treads.
This Hecarim, peeling him off the team, his tankiness and even the burst damage coming through from the Ignite and the Trinity Force procs, don't know how Legacy are going
to
deal with it.
I think it's going to be a little bit of let's get a catch and try and get the hell out before that teleport comes through from Perfection. So.
And they've already shown that's a game plan they can work.
Yeah.
Vi and Zed into Akarthus, they were able to execute that perfectly against Team Immunity 2 days ago and picked up objectives. But they had an objective snowball already happening this game, and certainly no objective snowball here. Dead even in both structures and dragons.
Yeah, but that structure's score is going to be heightened now for the Direwolves as Minkywell comes around, doesn't quite manage to find the slow, and the horse is going to make it away more than safely. Of course, probably wasn't under any threat of death at all anyway, as Carbon actually going to get altered here by Chuffer, forced a body slam over the edge, and there's actually the Dark Binding going to land. Soulstrike getting moved away by that explosive cast. Carbon looking to try and turn this one around as Choo-choo's forces the flash out of King, distorts his way back here as well as the teleports are both coming through. Perfections, he's in amongst the fighters. Sharp's going to take down Carbon. Minkywell trying to be a threat in the front line, but he's just not doing all that much. Perfections taking a whole lot of damage. Tallywhacker, he ults him up, but Perfections doesn't die, and that's a double kill for Soulstrike. Almost a triple, but King picks it up, and Minkywell finds himself the only man standing.
Four kills for one, and that all came from excellent positioning from King. He was able to kite backwards, fight in the brush towards the entrance of the enemy's blue buff, and just get free auto attacks down while Perfection was buying time, so tanky in the front line. Needed the Mikhails to live through the fight, but when the re-engage happened, could go in aggressively, King. They ripped through the back line. That should be Baron coming through for the Direwolves.
Yeah, an easy Baron here as well from the Direwolves. They're going to pick that one up with no contest at all. Of course, the rest of the members of Legacy Legacy still dead, and here's the replay.
So, of course, Carbon reinitiates. He'd already used his ult at this point. Watch King, though. He's able to do so much damage for free. The full culling comes through from the backline. Sharp and King are the MVPs for Direwolves. They're the ones you need to take down, but they're free hitting or poking from the backside. Perfection, he lives so long in the front, and that's when King can get in so aggressively. The backline was chunked out. The backline's taken down, and Direwolves, that's a Baron.
Yeah, it's massive here, and King was at full health at the end of that fight. Of course, you may have noticed Minky Whale's slight drive-by ultimate there as well was a little bit amusing. We'll see whether he can make that a little bit more effective with the knock-up as Ejim takes the majority of his health bar almost from that one spell from Sharp, who's really starting to rack up the damage.
And the potency of the Unstoppable Onslaught pales in comparison to the targeted nature of the Onslaught of Shadows when you're fighting outside of, say, the mid lane, you know, in an open area. When you're fighting in a jungle, okay, it's a fairly open area, but there's narrow crevices. You could see the Onslaught of Shadows was well on point from Perfection. He can aim it, he can use it so well. The ultimate from Minky Whale didn't contribute anything.
It didn't quite find the knockups that it needed to, and that is going to be the third dragon. The movement speed now picked up from the Direwolves.
Horsey's happier.
Oh yeah, that's actually the damage buff for the Hecarim here.
He doesn't need
a
damage buff. Look at the items putting together. He's got the second Warden's Mail, probably going to be a Randall. It's going to be shrugging off the AD based burst damage coming through from Tallywhacker. We saw him live a long time in that fight, Atlas. Okay, yep. He needed the Mikhaels. I don't think he's going to need the Mikhaels next time.
I don't think he's going to need much at all, as King's actually decided to start building his defensive item now, as well as Inner Turret is just going to melt into the hands of the Direwolves here, as well as Legacy trying to defend, positioning themselves as Carbon. Very, very tanky, actually. The Unstoppable Onslaught actually coming through from Minky Whale to clear out some minions.
It's on a very short cooldown at 40% CDR at level 16. It's only 36 seconds. In this case, probably around 50 seconds. It's probably not going to be a significant factor. It doesn't look like the re-engage is going to happen. So look, he got to the fight fast. That's all we have to worry about.
Yeah, he did. Perfection's getting chunked out here just a little bit by Choo Choo's. Trying to make sure that the Onslaught of Shadows can't come through too easily.
Unstoppable Onslaught, Onslaught of Shadows. We're getting there.
Unstoppable Onslaught of Shadows Force.
That could still happen this game.
If only it could, as King's going to take a little bit of burst. Tallywhacker actually getting caught by the Binding, though, immediately deleted. Minky Whale trying to zone out the carries here as Ejim takes half of his health, explosive cast to try and get them off, but the shutdown onto Perfections and Legacy. They get rid of the horse, and this might mean Direwolves have to turn around, but Carbon still has to deal with King and his massive damage. Darkbinding not going to find another target.
They're waiting for the minion wave. It's still a barrened up minion wave. You'll take the AD carry, dying for Perfection, but they need to get a structure. This is all for naught.
Yeah, Soulstrike's actually taking a lot of damage. There's the Unstoppable Onslaught yet again as Carbon's going to take down Chopper. So many low health bars on the side of Direwolves as Legacy trying to turn it on. Now King still alive in that backline. Carbon going to survive as well as Minky Whale looks for the Q but doesn't quite get it. They lose their tower, but Legacy, they do defend the inhibitor.
But still a good trade for the Direwolves. Breaking the base is always a significant thing, despite the fact that I say Legacy weren't really looking to siege themselves. You look at the Direwolves lineup, Xerath's good in a siege, but in terms of turret damage, Lucian's 500 range. Xerath, he doesn't want to be auto-attacking. He knows that Annie's got his name written on the to-kill list,
number one
by far after the previous two picks. They don't have the best siege team themselves, the Direwolves, so breaking the base, that's massive for this team.
Yeah, it's huge. Tallywhacker going to try and take away some Raptors as well. It was a nice steal of the red buff there for King, who probably wants to pick up some life steal because that red buff did take him down relatively low. He's now just going to clear out that mid wave and head back to base. As the Direwolves now going to reset this one. The Baron buff has worn off, so a little bit of pressure has been relieved from Legacy. And we'll see whether they can get on that front foot and really get a pick around this map and start to break open the Direwolves base, because you saw, when we've got 5 versus 5, things look dangerous here for Legacy.
They do look dangerous, and Legacy, if they get the catch, the teamfights can go their way. They just haven't been doing that, and they've broken, they had their base broken. If they make one more mistake, this, with the death timers getting longer and longer, the chance of the game being finished from the Direwolves is high. So Legacy, they need to get the wards down. The warding has been their excellent thing this week. They've been so on point with their warding and their rotations thusly. Because they're so far on the back foot, it feels like more than 8,000 gold from the Direwolves. That's probably because of just the scaling of the champions coming through from the likes of Hecarim and Xerath. And Legacy, they're just kind of at a loss as to what to do.
Yeah, they don't quite know where to make these picks, where to make their moves on this map, because it just feels like they're not in this game with a chance anymore. They need to get it needs to be based off a mistake here from the Direwolves to get Legacy into this one. We, of course, do have a slight pause coming through, which is why we're going to be now on your screen. But is this time for Legacy to sort of think about what to do next, or is there a way back into this game?
I think there's still a way back in the game. There's no inhibitor down. There's still no global pressure on them. They're still able to push up their waves, get some wards down, and get a pick. It's also worth considering that both these AD carries are going for a very tank-busting build. It's the highest amount of single-target damage. Infinity Edge, Phantom Dancer, Last Whisper. Yeah. So they are able to take down the super tanks. Even Perfection fell down relatively quickly for how tanky he is, because the tank busting is coming through. We saw a previous game where we saw two Yomu's AD carries having 6 seconds of damage and then just, you know, staring at tanks like Sahn and saying, got nothing, mate. But in this situation, they do have tank-killing damage. Graves, if he can use that quick draw aggressively, it's an attack speed steroid. We almost forget that because people have to hold on to it. They do have the potential to win a fight. It's so hard.
Oh, yeah. Tallywhacker does have the lifesteal advantage at this stage, but it is going to be a full Banshee's Veil to that QSS. Soulstrike's going to take a combo here from Choo Choo's, who does land the chain here as well. Arcano Pulse going to pop the ultimate now as well. Choo Choo's! Oh, my goodness. He's forced to use the flash. That was almost the most beautiful play from Sharp. Is the culling going to come through? King canceling that one relatively early as Minkywell was tanking that one up, and it's almost not worth using it.
And the targeting coming through from Sharp on the ultimate was massive, forcing the flash away. This is a cleanse LeBlanc. Can't even use the flash for the aggressive re-engage, so it should be pretty significant. The kill price is going to be even lower now for the LeBlanc. Going to have to wait so passively, just no flash available.
Just ridiculous. Praysaker not going to find any targets here as Legacy trying to defend their inhibitor. Perfection's running incredibly fast as Minkywell's trying to keep them out of the base. Just be a massive tanky threat.
But they're scared of this Annie. They're scared of the engage. Xerath can't get anywhere near the inhibitor, and you have to say neither can Lucian. 500 range champions. They have to respect the engage, so that means this inhibitor, it could last a while.
It could. If Ejim continues to get the same level of respect. Direwolves now just going to retreat. 40 seconds is on the Baron, also on the Dragon here as well as Legacy. They're looking to have caught Soulstrikes here as well. The Chain's not going to find it as Minkywell's going to find the ultimate here as well. Desert Mating Smash going to land onto Sharp, who's forced to flash away, but Legacy's members are so low now. Perfection takes down Ejim. It's a beautiful ultimate from Sharp here as well as Tallywhacker. He's running as fast as he can, launched on by Perfection. Minkywell now the last man standing yet again. Carbon nowhere near this team fight as Soulstrike's ults to the bottom lane to get some farm.
And the fight's still on though.
Is this really a fight? Because Minkywell's just gonna get destroyed. Can't really offer too much damage, and Direwolves, they may have just got led into the base.
I mean, that was just a crazy fight coming through from the Direwolves. The engage happened from Minky. It hit a priority target, but the big issue for them is the difference between the Onslaught of Shadows and the Unstoppable Onslaught, the difference between Hecarim and Sion, is that Hecarim does a hell of a lot of burst damage, as well as being super, super tanky. That's not the case earlier in the game. It took 20 minutes for the Trinity Force to come through. That's a 20-minute window for Sion to be so impactful around the map. Even in the early game, when there's no resist, there's no Banshee Veil through, that's the real thing. So we see the engage coming through. Minky comes in aggressively, almost hits Sharp, but it hits the damage on Sharp. But Perfection shows up, King shows up, has the Banshee Veil, so it can finally position aggressively against the Annie. We already saw the Sharp mechanics were on point, but watch this burst damage. That's just a Lucian piercing light and the Trinity Force devastating charge proc coming through from Hecarim, and that's a dead AD carry.
Yeah, just so much damage coming through. We talked about it. There's a reason that Legacy, I guess I was going to say consistently abandoned, but they haven't. They're the team that's let it through, and you can see why all the other teams in the OPL have just not wanted to play against it. He's scaled up. He's an absolute beast. Baron is still alive. The Dragon's ready as well, but not a lot left here for Legacy to try and take, and they're so far behind in gold.
I mean, the crazy thing to me, Pastry Time, is the fact that let's go back to other regions. Let's talk about, for example, SK Telecom TK1 when they were still around. People always talked about the fact that they would want to leave the priority picks for the enemy team up in the first match of a best of five. Remember, this is a best of five, ladies and gentlemen. And then beat those priority picks and just completely remove any morale from the enemy team. Maybe that's the thought press coming through from Legacy, because you have to say this gambit of leaving up the Perfection's Hecarim, leaving up Sharp's Xerath, his 3-0 champion, it hasn't worked.
No, it being a long series is a great point. This is only game one of a potential five, and Legacy have shown a lot of experience. They're sort of the veteran best of five team in Oceania, or one of them. So Direwolves, you know, adjusting, you're going to feel happy here with some comfort, but Dialogues are a team that are just so scary when it comes to giving them momentum, and I don't know if I leave Hecarim up just for this exact reason. If they do win on their comfort picks, they're going to feel so together and so strong
as a team.
There's
just so many crazy things to remember. They gave them their preferable picks. I said to Atlas, it was almost a blind pick team coming through from the Direwolves. And then you also consider the fact that they didn't even lane swap. They went standard against the Direwolves, who love standard. They love 1v1. That's when Hecarim and Perfection in particular can get those big CS advantage. That is when all their people look so comfortable. It's only when rotations happen that the team kind of falls apart in the mid game. In the late game, if they get the items, they're still a great team fighting team with their mechanical skills. But Legacy, they never got the rotations we expected. They never went for the lane swap and could really pressure with the Annie. I don't think they're going to win this game.
I mean, they're still fighting. Those Soul Strikes might have been caught out. It's very tanky, though, and Shuffer will keep him safe with the Black Shield. So Baron still up for now. Perfection causing trouble in the bottom side for Minky. Well, actually just pushing in. No inhibitor to potentially take. He's just forcing Minky away and letting the rest of his team potentially get on top of that Baron.
And forcing in Super Minions. He has much more AoE wave clear, so he's just happy to push in the Super Minions. And it's not many good decisions for Legacy. That Tallywhack is stuck in the mid trying to clear minions. They're going to try and answer this Baron, but it's going to go down quickly.
Yeah, and that last Whisper meaning that Perfection actually does very realistic damage, even to a super tank like Sion. You saw eventually with the help of the minions and some of his items that he got it down. Baron is down, though. Carbon now maybe now caught. Chopper going to miss the first button as Carbon slams out of the way. But Hecarim now coming around the side. A good ulti might keep him safe, but Perfection will not be denied for much longer. The Black Shield's going to churn as well. And Carbon actually gets cancelled. I think he got body slammed out. I couldn't make it over the thick wall, but Perfection still going to chase him down. Has his ulti if he needs to ignite ready to go as well. But he's going to keep chasing. Soul Strikes will come for a bit of extra damage. Carbon, he'll buy some time, but he eventually goes down.
He buys time. That's the more significant. The base is already in tatters. So killing one member buys time for the enemy to try and get in position. They're not going to be able to take it. And there's the engage.
Ejim going in onto King. They really need the kill, but they can't quite find it. Choo-choo's goes in. Tally actually does get the assassination, but LeBlanc will go down. The double kill there is sharp. Assassinates Ejim. Tally now getting destroyed by all of that Xerath damage and eventually forced to Perfection. He homeguard Tally back in, and the dial is just going to run out over Legacy's base.
Yeah, will they be able to finish the game? They have two waves of super minions. Only one ranged auto attacker. Sharp's finally grouping with the team. It's only Sion. So this should be the first game of the best of five to Direwolves.
Minions doing so much work there. Second tower's gonna fall and Minky just can't do anything. Death time is too long at this stage and Direwolves will take their first game.
Just a crazy performance from the Direwolves, but the real craziness was the draft coming through from Legacy. They know as well as we do how good Perfection is on this Hecarim. They know as well as we do that Xerath is another priority pick coming through for the Direwolves, but they got everything they wanted and they took down this game.
I mean, I like the idea that, you know, get aggressive, try and get a mid-game advantage, but the Wolves just kept snowballing and eventually got to outscale them. We actually have a replay from the last game there as well, just to see just how strong this horse was.
So this game was really close for 25 minutes, and that would trap you into thinking, okay, that suits Legacy. But remember, they have the mid-game team. They have short-range champions. They have early power spikes. Direwolves were able to keep up with a Hecarim, with a Xerath, trying to just farm up. So again, Direwolves have a slim lead, but this is the fight that really cemented the bigger lead coming through for the Direwolves. So we'll roll the tape. Carbon's very, very tanky. He's caught by a bind. That's not the big deal. But remember, the explosive cast, it's on cooldown. So watch King in this fight. He was the significant one. Flashes away from Choo-Choo's. Then both the priority champions, both Xerath and Lucian, auto-attacking for free at the back. They kill Carbon. Still, King is at full health. Changes his attention. Perfection is so, so tanky. Just like the Sion, but he's a bit more regular with engages. He lives through all this, which is crazy to begin with. But King and Sharp showing up. Both those priority carries at full health could get through the backline because the backline from Minky, he'd already left the fight. He tried to get the massive unstoppable onslaught in, couldn't do it. And then there's onslaught of Shadows and Hecarim. It looked good for Direwolves.
It looked great for Direwolves. You know, for a little bit more on that game, we're going to go throw out back outside to Atlas and Raider, who are standing by for a bit more analysis.
Thank you very much, Pacer Time. I am here with Raider after that game. And that was ridiculous. The Direwolves basically getting exactly what they wanted.
Yeah, I mean, Perfection on Hecarim, as you saw, he's a monster. I mean, Sharp Xerath is like one of his most played this season, I think. And also King's Lucian, who played that 32-minute team fight really, really well. I mean, he flashed out of LeBlanc's ulti, he dodged his chains, and just put out so much damage. I mean, like, they all got their comfort champions, and this was the result, as you saw.
Yeah, well, it's true. And what do you think's going through the minds of Legacy now? Do they think that, okay, we've let them have their comfort picks, now let's try and dismantle this tactic in the pick and ban phase? Is this something that Legacy might have thought of immediately because it's a best of five series?
Yeah, I think so. I think they'll definitely rewrite their drafting strategy here. I mean, you gave Direwolves, like, all their comfort picks, and as you saw, they played really, really well. I mean, I mean, towards, like, you know, Sharp got picked off a few times, but towards the end of the game, he just became really, really strong. I mean, like, Direwolves had a scaling team comp. They won some mid-game team fights. They got to late game, and they just steamrolled the game from there.
Yeah, it's a little bit crazy. And we've seen ChuChu's on the LeBlanc before. We've seen him go off. We've seen him do amazing things. But that cleanse pickup really looked like it hurt him as far as being able to secure those kills. Why do you think that came through?
I mean, cleanse, it's against a team with Xerath and Morgana, a lot of the times you will be looking to, you know, W in and try to make picks as LeBlanc. And a lot of times you will find that when you play LeBlanc, if you W in and then get stunned, you get Xerath stunned into Morgana bind, you won't be able to W back to where you originally came from and you just die. I mean, he does sacrifice some kill pressure mid-game without the ignite, but I think he went for more of a safety net, but I think that ultimately cost him a few kills that he could have gotten more.
Yeah, well, it's true, and I guess you're exactly right, making sure that he can get as much teamfight damage down as he could, but it looked like Legacy were more trying to look for the picks. And do you think it was about sort of Direwolves having this brilliant vision scheme, the playstyle around the mid-game that stopped that snowball from ever occurring?
I mean, yeah, I mean, like, I think definitely, I would say that they had so much, Direwolves had a lot of vision control. I think Legacy, actually, they do have a very team fight, engage-heavy team, but I think they're overcommitted in some team fights.
Yep.
And once you overcommit, once you use your dashes offensively, once you use your flashes offensively, I mean, you have a Fed Hecarim who just uses Onslaught of Shadows into your back line and just kind of destroys them as you start that game.
Yeah.
And, you know, and once that happens, with the Lucian will come in, the Xerath ulti will come in, it'll just clean up your entire team.
Yeah, well, we'll see whether it's going to happen in Game 2, ladies and gentlemen, because that is going to be coming up right after this short break, guys. Don't go anywhere.